A live discussion on Homer's Odyssey.
Speak memory of the cunning hero, the wanderer, blown off course time and again after he plundered Troy's sacred heights. Speak of all the cities he saw, the mines he grasped, the suffering deep in his heart at sea as he struggled to survive and bring his men home, but could not save them, hard as he tried. The fools, destroyed by their own recklessness, when they ate the cattle of Hyperion the sun, and that god snuffed out their day of return. Of all these things, speak, immortal one, and tell the tale once more in our time.
Stanley Lombardo, professor of classics at the University of Kansas. Who was Homer?
Homer was the greatest poet who ever lived. In tradition, all we know about him is that he was a blind bard from the rocky island of Chios. He lived in the 8th century, perhaps, BCE. He composed, probably entirely without the aid of writing, the great epic poems, Iliad and Odyssey. He was not only a composer, but a performer. That's really all we know about him.
What was the Odyssey? What's the story?
The Odyssey is the story of the return home of Odysseus after the Trojan War. Odysseus had left his wife and infant son, sailed to Troy from Ithaca, where he was king, with 12 ships, fought in the war for 10 years, was responsible for the winning stratagem, the wooden horse, which finally allowed the Greeks to take the city, and then spent 10 years returning home. The Odyssey picks up the story just a few weeks, really, before he returns home. And by means of various devices, flashback and so forth, and other characters filling in, we get the entire story of his return home, the 10 years that he took to return home from Troy. It's a story about a man who, a veteran, a war veteran, who comes back home under difficult circumstances and picks up the pieces of his life successfully.
Author, journalist Christopher Hitchens, is there any relevance to the Odyssey in today?
I'd just like to say that even that minimum is not indisputable. We're not absolutely certain Homer was one real person. I've been to the rock on Chios, where he is supposed to have sat, but Chios is only one of, I believe, seven places that claims him, and there was a later poet who said, seven cities now contend for Homer dead, through which the living Homer begged his bread, which goes to show that bards, no more than prophets, are honored in their own country. Yes, to your point of relevance, even if it was the work of many hands, and the oral tradition, or the griot, as you seem to imply with your drum, absolutely, it's relevant, because from your very first invocation, we get the idea of hubris and nemesis, right, which is a thing we can't do without in ordinary discourse. There are certain punishments that appear to fall on people that, for original arrogance or conceit, that we can't conceive of relating grand stories without. Nostalgia, a very overused and sentimentalized term now, which literally means, and can only really mean, the yearning to go home, to be home again, and nothing else will do. The extraordinary caprice of the gods, the eternal conundrum, at least for believers, if there are gods, why are they so mean to us? Or if there is a god, why is he so mean to us? Which can be solved by having lots of gods and different caprices, rival caprices. All of this, and all through our modern literature, there are people who've been stirred by it, who've tried to reinterpret it, from James Joyce in our century just closing to Alexander Pope and Chapman. People think of it as the original narrative of the striving of humanity and of the need also to beware of what you want in case you ever do, as Cavafy says, if finally get home to Ithaca. It may turn out that it's better to travel, hopefully, than to arrive.
Jay Bottom, do you remember the first time that you read the Odyssey?
I do. I read it because we've just been given Tennyson to read about Ulysses in old age and what actually happened to him after he had arrived in Ithaca, and how in Tennyson's reading he had to set forth again in old age because traveling is better, finally. And that sent me to the Odyssey. And then...
How old were you?
Oh, 12, 13, in there somewhere. I wasn't a Grecian as a child, so I didn't have Professor Lombard's learning, but it's a story that once heard, of course, you never forget, but then on the other hand, you never actually ever first heard it. It's written so deep into all of our stories that you can't actually remember a time when you didn't know something about this story, whether you'd read Homer or not. It is the story of the Greeks. It's the story of half of our civilization.
You are the book editor for this publication, The Weekly Standard, very political publication. Is there politics?
In Homer?
In the Odyssey.
In the Odyssey. Homer. Oh, yeah, there are the eternal themes of politics, rivalry, jealousy, forming groups, how one wins over a populace, how one rules as a king, how one, and most important, I suppose, the perpetual problem of politics, how one hands on power. If you remember in the Odyssey, of course, the whole first set of books are not about Odysseus at all. They're about his son and how his son becomes a man. And the perpetual theme of politics is, in fact, how it is that power may be transferred from father to son, from leader to leader.
Deborah Dickerson, when...
I can't resist, I'm sorry, adding...
Sure,
it.
Well, go ahead.
No, I mean, it may seem too contemporary, but it also shows that even the highest aspirations of politics can be unhorsed by what people will do for women. And the lengths to which they will go, and the way in which self-interest, which is the highest political concept, or the most familiar one, dissolves when passion is involved. And there's the original hubris.
Deborah Dickerson, Chris Hedges, of the New York Times, wrote the review of Professor Lombardo's translation of the Odyssey in the New York Times, and he wrote that every recruit headed into war would be well advised to read the Iliad, just as every soldier returning home would be served by reading the Odyssey. You were in the military. Were you able to bring that experience into it as you were reading the Odyssey?
Not from Odysseus's point of view, because I was never in combat, but from the point of view of someone who's not Penelope, but who's closer to the action. Because I was not in combat, but because I was directly responsible for people who were, there was the constant worrying. Your heart and mind was never where your body was, because you're wondering what's happening to these people that I can put names and faces to, friends of mine I was in during the Persian Gulf War who were flying combat air patrols over Iraq. And you know, did he make it back today? Did he fly today? What's going on with him? So not from the point of view of the soldier, but from the point of view of someone who's more involved than a loved one who doesn't know anything. And on the political tip, I wasn't really struck by the larger macro issues that y'all raised. I was struck by the micro political issues. Now, I was very interested in the slaves and their response to oppression, because in the margins, there was a lot there to think about. There was this constant implicit comparison between the good slaves and the bad slaves, and the good slaves had this nobility imparted to them, and in one case actually was a noble, the swineherd. I thought it was also so ironic that the godlike Odysseus ends up fighting with his son, a swineherd, and the cattle herder. I thought that was really interesting, speaking of hubris and being able to use what you've got. But I was struck by the plight of women. Not that I was reading it with this sort of PC mindset, but of course I can relate to Penelope, you know, and what she should do and what she shouldn't do, and the servants, should they consider Odysseus's problems their own and think of him as a brother, or should they just make the best they can of any particular situation? And I don't really know the answers to these questions, but I thought there were some interesting examples laid out. But clearly Homer took a position, and also the fact that just the references to, I'm really, really interested to ordinary life in other times, and I'm wondering things like, do they ever eat anything besides red meat and red wine and bread? Does someone always bathe you and rub you with oil? And when he was with Calypso, who was a goddess, she still waited on him. You know, she gave him his food and all that stuff. Even goddesses have to wait on their mortal. So I was very, very interested. Right. So I was really interested in just sort of the daily life. The beautiful goddess, right. So I just, it was that, the daily life. And also the fact that Poseidon was off with the Ethiopians, you know, when his son, the Cyclops, was being, there's so many details in there. That was when the Cyclops was being blinded, wasn't it?
Yes.
And I thought, well, that's really interesting. So it talks about, and there were so many references to other countries, Sicily and this sort of thing. It's amazing the amount of time, how big their world was, given how low their technology was.
And lots of islands claim, as Chios does, to be Homer's original domain. Lots of islands, most credibly Malta, claim to be Calypso's.
We have this geography here, this little map that was inside that might help out. Professor, can you help us with this? What is this?
We're not going to see Malta there. What we see there is the peninsula of Greece and then Troy, which is actually an inset. You can point to the inset.
Yes, right
Troy,
here.
And then on the coastline.
Turkey, which is, I think, where Deborah was a soldier.
Yeah.
Right, during the Persian Gulf War.
Yeah.
Right.
The Turks weren't there.
No.
So if you move from the inset over, you can see Troy, the northern coast of Turkey. Go up.
I had found it earlier, and why can't I put my hand? Oh, there it is, right here.
Yeah, I think
right
point to it. And so the return from Troy for the Greeks would have been across the Aegean Sea, and for Odysseus it would be down around the Cape at the bottom, mm-hmm. and then back up to Ithaca. And it's probably at that point where you're just rounding the Cape that he's blown off course and his adventures begin.
Is this real geography?
That's real geography. The parageography, as it happens, is all off the map, that particular map, which might be just as well.
Well, we have a rough idea where the Pillars of Hercules would have been.
I'm sorry?
We have a rough idea where the Pillars of Hercules would have been.
Yeah, we know where they are.
Straits of Gibraltar are, so the Symplegades, I think they were called. And then, so Malta would be not implausible. But it is true that, I mean, the Greeks regularly paid homage to Egypt and to Ethiopia as places from which they had drawn and learned. Great deal. Herodotus does it, and the Egyptians, I mean, Alexander the Great, who carried the Iliad wherever he went in a golden box, had as his highest ambition to be made a pharaoh, because it was thought you couldn't do any better than Egypt. Though the Egyptians thought that the Egyptians thought there was much to be learned from the Ethiopians. So they were very, because they were maritime and because Mediterranean still means center of the world, they were very internationalist in a way.
And because they were maritime, their lives were so uncertain. Your husband would go off on a 3-hour tour, you know, and years go by. Is he alive? Is he dead? Should I remarry? You know, what's the relationship of the new husband to the son? So it's no wonder that their greatest sagas have to do with that, with these incredible encounters, you know, Scylla and Charybdis. And who are the Lotus Eaters? I never figured that out. Where is that?
Well, some people would think that's somewhere on the northern coast of Africa, but again, this is all just the geography of the imagination. More important would be what the Lotus Eaters represent.
Right.
You know, this. If you're taking this as Jonathan Shea reads the Iliad and the Odyssey, his book Achilles in Vietnam, I think a very important book for this decade. You know, he noticed that the transcripts he was taking from Vietnam veterans, working with them in Boston, actually resembled speeches in the Iliad, and he got very interested in all of this. He's now working on a book, Odysseus in America, and he takes all of the adventures of Odysseus and reads them allegorically as, the technical term is bullshitting, actually, what a combat veteran will do when asked by a civilian, oh, tell me how it was in Vietnam. Well, the civilian has no way to understand what it was really like. And so, bullshitting. So the Lotus Eaters in his allegorical representation would, of course, just be the recourse to drugs as, you know, one thing that veterans might do in dealing with post-traumatic stress disorder.
Well, eating lotus gives you amnesia, makes it all go away.
Right.
Yeah.
And you forget home.
You don't want to go home anymore.
An analgesic injury.
Yeah.
Jay Bottom, you said you first read this at about the age of 12. Would you consider yourself a purist when it comes to the classics?
Well, I don't know what that means.
Would you prefer a translation that is pure to the original than, let's say, Professor Lombardo's, who is, this is new translation, which is, one could say, quite hip.
Well, here we get down to it then. This line about that you quoted, Homer, the Odyssey, and the Iliad are books that you ought to give soldiers. It's absolutely true. I just don't think you ought to give them this book. The experience is universal. The experience that we're talking about here is universal. But Homer has something beyond the universal experience. He has something to teach us, not merely something to repeat to us. And what he has to teach us is a kind of nobility, a kind of understanding of how it is that the human being can rise above these circumstances and understand what it is to live according to the virtues, to live a life that, though it's tragic and short and filled with storms and angry gods, nonetheless is complete and whole and honorable. Now, what Professor Lombardo has given us here is the experience, that universal experience, and he's done it very well. His description of Homer in Vietnam, that's perfect for what he's done. He's repeated the experience. But what got lost, I'm afraid, is the nobility of Homer. Matthew Arnold wrote a famous essay called On Translating Homer. It's mostly about the Iliad, but there are a few references to the Odyssey in it. And he lists four things that Homer always is. Homer is always simple, Homer is always direct, Homer is always rapid. And Professor Lombardo's got the rapidity here, more than anyone since Pope. But the fourth thing is that Homer is always noble. And what we have here is something that seems to me, much as I liked it, it's really great stuff a lot of the time, but the rhythms aren't consistent. We get 6-foot lines, we get 3-foot lines, we've got hexameter rolling along, we've got little snippets, and the kind of rhythmic form that Homer has is what's completely lost here. This loud lines that you had to train your whole life to be able to get enough breath to repeat a whole Homeric line. That's all gone here. What we got are essentially the lines of song lyrics.
Professor, let's listen to some more. Do you have something else?
Well, you know, since Jay brought up the sound of the Greek.
Jody.
I'm sorry. The sound of the Greek, perhaps it'd be just as well to get it out in the air. Mm. Here would be the opening lines.
In Greek.
In Greek, right. So it's what I read at the beginning of the program. And you do have to train to be able to get these long sentences out.
And why the drum?
Well, you know, Homer probably performed with a lyre, but it probably was not used for melody, but perhaps just striking a few chords every now and then. And another, almost as a percussion instrument, another form of performance in the ancient world. The rhapsodes would use a staff. So this kind of, and perhaps beat the ground to keep time. So this combines the two, actually, in some kind of a postmodern shamanic way.
Andra moyane pemosa, polutropon, os malapola plante, Epe Troyes hieron toliathron e person. Polon d'anthropon didenastea kai noon egno. Pola dogen ponto pathanalgea hon katuthumon. Arnumenos heinteps eucain kai noston hetairon. Aludos heterus erusato hi emenos per. Auton gars veteres in atas thalies in nolonto, nepioi, hoi catabus huperionos e elioeo eistion. Autoroteos apelata nos dimonemar. Ton hamothenge the a thugater dios, epe kai hemin.
Christopher Hitchens.
When Homer smote his blooming lyre, as the name of the book, one of Kipling's, came back to me when Jody was speaking. If Homer is terse and as swift as he is, I'm not sure that that'll quite carry your point about honor and virtue, because sometimes you blink and you think, yes, in those two lines you just said how Odysseus, having left Troy, landed on, it might have been Imbros or Tenedos, made short work of the civilians, collectivized and sold the women burned everything he couldn't carry away. And so I think, wow, there's a lot condensed into that. In other words, the idea of the soldier's life is represented without any euphemism at all. I mean, sometimes they gloat over violence, and sometimes you realize that, yes, men like listening to this because men love this stuff, the way the sword goes in under the breastbone or under the chin, and the feel and the crunch of it. But there's also the absolute pitilessness of it, and the feeling that it must be justified. And the best way to justify it is to say, you're doing it on behalf of your wives and children at home. You're doing this to the other people's wives and children. They're the necessary invocation. All the more important, then, that he has to be always represented as not forgetting the family or the family values in which this actually rather hectic bit of plunder in Troy has been undertaken.
But when you
exercise in vanity and also in the, well, I don't want to call it the conceit exactly, because I don't want to dishonor the soldiery, but the idea that, look, anything may be better than the pastoral life on some island, and if you get a chance to get into a long ship, a dark ship, and go and try and win a golden reputation, seize it. And who cares about the survivors?
Well, reputation is not divorced from honor. I mean, reputation is honor. It's a debased form of it in our own time. But, I mean, it strikes me as really revealing, Christopher, that you'd say, well, you know, there's no euphemism here. Well, the appeal to the virtues for Homer is not euphemism. I mean, that's the tragedy of our own age, is that when we speak about it, it becomes very difficult for a soldier, even a soldier, to get up and talk about things like a soldier's honor, bravery, the military virtues, because they sound false in our mouths as we say them. You know that they're real, but to talk about them in public sounds false. But Homer lives in a time when there isn't that big a gap between the language and the moral sense. Now, we may disagree with that moral sense, but the moral sense is real, and the language matches it. And they know when they have been vicious. They know when they've fallen into vice. And they know the language to speak it. And that's what I don't get here. There isn't a high language with which to address the kind of issues that are actually present for Homer in Professor Lombardo's translation. So that the kind of key moment for me came when Odysseus pours the blood out, and he calls up the ghosts, and here comes Achilles. And Odysseus, you know, says, oh, well, you've been freed from the eternal suffering, you know, you're dead. And Achilles answers, now, the great hero whose failures and vices are essentially the story of the Iliad is now called up as his ghost, and he says, oh, don't try and sell me on death. Well, it's diction that's let us down there. It's diction that's failed. That's not the high language that a hero would speak to understand his own actions, including his own failures.
We are, at this time, going to just take a brief break and tell you that in about 10 minutes, we're going to open up our phone lines and invite you to join in on this discussion. This is one of the first times that Book TV has attempted to discuss a classic. This is the first time we've done it live. We're interested in your questions and your comments, and also later on, what you think of this format and whether you'd like to see us continue it. We have chosen Homer's Odyssey as the first one to talk about. This is the book, and this is the new translation by Stanley Lombardo. He teaches classics at the University of Kansas, and he's joining us today. We're going to ask him to continue leading this discussion, and with him, Christopher Hitchens, who's an author and a journalist, has a new book coming out in January.
Hope so. maybe soon.
What's it about?
It's called Unacknowledged Legislation, which is a line stolen from Shelley, and it's about the effect of writers on the public sphere, of literature on the public sphere.
Jody Bottom, who writes for the Weekly Standard, is the book editor there for how long?
2 years now.
And prior to that?
I was at a little religious magazine in New York called First Things.
And Deborah Dickerson is also with us on her own book tour right now for this book, An American Story. What's it like to be on this book tour?
I'm really glad to be here on the show because it's in D.C., which is where I live. The book tour is very rewarding because those are the people you wrote it for. And, you know, people who don't like you don't show up. People who like you show up. So it's rewarding but tiring.
What would Homer be like on a book tour, do you think?
I feel a little like Homer. But I don't feel very noble, so I guess not.
He would need a guide dog.
He would need a guide dog, but hopefully no visits from the dead.
202-624-1111 if you live in the East or Central time zone, 202-624-1115 if you live in the Mountain or Pacific time zone. We can also take your questions through email if you'd like to email us at booktv@cspan.org. And Professor, let me turn next to you. If you want to begin again this kind of, as we try to replicate a book club discussion here, a theme in which you think that we should now move into.
Well, I'd like to read a little part from Book 8, where Odysseus is on the island of the Phaeacians. They are going to give him safe passage home. He is being entertained at a feast by the blind bard Demodocus, who may represent Homer himself. And Demodocus has just sung a brief part of the story of the Trojan War. And Odysseus turns to him and says, "You are an amazing poet, but now I'd like for you to sing the story of the wooden horse," which of course Odysseus was in, and that was, you know, his stratagem. So the bard is reading that story, and Odysseus is listening to it, and his reaction to the story that the bard sings is what I'd like for us to consider. So he spoke, and the bard, moved by the god, began to sing. He made them see it happen, how the Greeks set fire to their huts on the beach and were sailing away, while Odysseus and the picked men with him sat in the horse, which the Trojans had dragged into their city. There the horse stood, and the Trojans sat around it and could not decide what they should do. There were three ways of thinking. Hack open the timbers with pitiless bronze, or throw it from the heights to the rocks below, or let it stand as an offering to appease the gods. The last was what would happen, for it was fated that the city would perish once it enclosed the great wooden horse, in which now sat the Greek heroes who had spilled Troy's blood. The song went on. The Greeks poured out of their hollow ambush and sacked the city. He sang how one hero here and another there ravaged tall Troy, but how Odysseus went like the war god himself with Menelaus to the house of Deiphobus. And there, he said, Odysseus fought his most daring battle and won with the help of Pallas Athena. This was his song, and Odysseus wept. Tears welled up in his eyes and flowed down his cheeks. A woman wails as she throws herself upon her husband's body. He has fallen in battle before the town walls, fighting to the last to defend his city and protect his children. As she sees him dying and gasping for breath, she clings to him and shrieks, while behind her, soldiers prod their spears into her shoulders and back. And as they lead her away into slavery, her tear-drenched face is a mask of pain. So too Odysseus, pitiful in his grief. The simile, which was in the translation, I indent the similes and set them off in italics, because the similes in Homer have a way of just floating into our consciousness almost as a flashback of either some traumatic or sublime experience. And it seems to me that's just what's happening to Odysseus here. His suffering at the moment when he's hearing the story of the Trojan War is compared to the suffering of a woman who is about to be led away into captivity. Her husband has just died. How many times must Odysseus have seen that? Now, we're not told explicitly, you know, that Odysseus is remembering that. This is rather part of Homer's poetic art, you know, kind of getting into Odysseus's subconscious. That's the passage I'd like to bring up for discussion.
Well, can I just make a general comment?
Sure.
In response to your comment, the obvious response is that this is accessible to the masses. You encountered the traditional Homer when you were 12. I encountered this 2 weeks ago. I've never read Homer. I've never read any of the classics. I studied Greek and Roman myths in a gifted elementary school, but that was it. If I had been given what I imagine a traditional, true to the original translation of Homer, I don't think I would have gotten through it. I don't think I would have gone the distance. I think I'm much more likely, and most, and I'm a pretty studious. I read all the time. I'm a studious person. I love literature, and I'm so much more likely now to pick up a much more faithful translation than without having read this. And I think, for the masses of people who are unfamiliar with the classics in their classical form, they're likely to start with this and end with this. But there'll be that, and this is very satisfying in its own right. But I think that for that small minority who are a little more thoughtful and who are really intrigued by this, they're less likely to start with an original. But I think they're more likely to start with this and then be intrigued to go back and read. And it would be wonderful, I think, to sort of see them side by side. Like, the scenes in Hades really made my skin crawl, and I would really love to compare, to see two renderings of that side by side. And I think the two of them would be so fulfilling together. But I would need this, I think, to get through that, especially the way you were saying these things would be rendered. You need these very long breaths, and the way things are metered differently. It's very difficult to start with that, especially if you don't have someone leading you, and who does once you get out of school?
Jody Bottom, what is the translation that you're holding there?
I was just looking at the parallel passage in Robert Fitzgerald's translation, just to make sure that my memory was right, and that what Professor Lombardo has indented as a lyric occurring somehow in the middle of this epic poem was in fact occurring in the epic line, and it's the bard speaking that. That's not a narrator come in sort of magically from outside the poem. That's the continuation. What Professor Lombardo has done is kind of inset that as though Homer had suddenly broken into lyric poetry in the middle of his epic, which again, it's great stuff that here, but there was a famous commentator who read a Grecian, one of the most famous classicists of all time, and he read Pope's. He was lived in the 18th century, and he read Pope's translation, and he says it's marvelous poetry. It's just not Homer, and that this is a good example.
Yeah. Was it not Walter Johnson who said that?
It was Johnson. Oh. A very nice poem.
I thought it was Bentley, but right.
A very nice poem, Mr. Lombardo.
Condescending massively.
Here's a translation of Richard Lattimore's, and here's a translation of Robert Fagel's. Mm-hmm. Both.
Which Bernard Knox, I think, wrote the.
Yes, Bernard Knox wrote the introduction to this one. So there are many translations.
You get the idea, though, when you said the bard, as you have it phrased, moved by the god speaks, that the bard is not doing it all by hand, as it were. I mean, that he is ventriloquizing. In a way, and then when Demosthenes has got quite a long way on with the story, the king, Antinous, I think, says, "But I notice that our guest is in tears; that he can't take it any longer. Maybe you should stop. Maybe you're not. Maybe it's ill-mannered of you to recall it with such graphic accuracy." You get the idea of catharsis that occurs later in Attic drama, of the pity and the terror that a proper representation will achieve and bring about. And Odysseus, who was there, still when he hears it being talked about, cracks up. Can't take it any longer. Which is a bit different from, I was thinking when you talked earlier about how soldiers, when later talking to civilians, tend to embellish. And you know how Shakespeare, who was much moved, much stirred by the Odyssey, has it in the speech before Agincourt, you know, how if you come through this battle, then you'll remember with advantages what deeds you did that day. You have all the soldier of fiction always making it seem as if it was much tougher than it was.
Well, and
this is not true in this case. This
no,
is someone
this is
who was there. And
this is entertainment for the Phaeacians.
Yeah.
For Odysseus, it's his own deeply disturbing history that he's still trying to deal with and trying to find a context in which he can deal with it. He's trying to communalize his experience, but his comrades are all dead. And when he'll go back to Ithaca, it'll be an entirely new generation.
But the Phaeacians want to send him on his way.
They do, yes.
And they feel he's suffered enough and should get home. And they're proud of their own longships and so on. But they feel they have a quarrel with Poseidon. Mm-hmm. Poseidon doesn't like them, thinks they're too proud of their seamanship. Which must be the worst possible news for Odysseus to hear, because he's already been victimized by Poseidon. And he's finally made landfall, but no, there's more to come.
Yeah.
And they're horribly punished, if I'm not, for helping him get home.
Yes.
Just incredible hardship and cruelty and sadness. They help this guy get home after all this time, and he finally gets there because of them. And then it wasn't clear to me exactly what happened. Walled off the city with the mountain, or it made the ship sink, it turned the ship into a big rock and it sunk. Does Odysseus even know that that happened?
No, he would have no knowledge of that.
He's already home. It's an amazing world that he was describing. Well, actually, it's a world pretty much like our own.
There are some other Shakespearean echoes in your translation. I noticed that in book four, I made note of it, you say, screw up your courage to the sticking point, which I think is from Macbeth, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes.
And the line that kept coming back to me when I was reading it, as it always does when I do, is, I think from Lear, it's as flies to wanton boys, so are we to the gods. They kill us for their sport.
That's right, yes.
And ever present, they're never more than a breathing away from the idea of some caprice from Olympus, some piece of random vengeance or spite, mere spite, in fact, except for Athena, who still seems to me to come through as the best of the gods that humans have invented for themselves.
you did this on purpose.
What is that?
Parallels with Shakespeare.
Yes. I am constantly alluding to the entire tradition of English and American poetry, and I'm especially pleased when people recognize those allusions. This is the way Homer himself worked. He was heir to a tradition of performance poetry that was perhaps 600 years old, and the cherished formulae that he weaves in and out, the fabric of the poem, really an important part of the poem's texture and aesthetic import in dealing with those formulaic expressions determined a large part of the poetics of this translation.
This translation is published by Hackett Publishing Company. Let's take our first call for our group. It's from Washington, D.C. Welcome to our group.
Hi, how are you doing?
Fine, thanks.
This is a question for Professor Lombardo. And I'm studying the Odyssey in school, and I was just wondering, what do you believe is the Odyssey's deeper meaning? For instance, what is the Odyssey really about? Is it a religious text showcasing the power of the gods, or just showing human struggle in a whole? What do you believe the Odyssey is really about?
Caller, can I ask you first how old you are?
I'm 15 years old.
And what school do you go to?
St. Albans.
And you're studying this in... you're studying this in class?
Yes, I am.
Do you like it?
Yeah, it's a good book. I mean, I'm reading the Fagles translation, which is very good, and I understand it very well, and I enjoy it quite much. I also think his description of battle scenes are very good.
Professor?
The Odyssey functions on many levels. In some sense, it is, if you will, a religious text. It's about the will of Zeus, as the Iliad is about the will of Zeus. It's Zeus who finally decides that that patient man, Odysseus, gets to go home. But, it's an intensely human poem. The first word of the Odyssey in Greek is andra, a man. It's a story about a man with a lot of intelligence, a lot of guts, courage, commitment, single-mindedness, who finally does make it home. It's a poem about courage and commitment, and it's as much about Odysseus as Penelope, who has all of those same qualities, intelligence, commitment. In fact, towards the end of the poem, Agamemnon, who had the opposite experience of Odysseus, a faithless wife who murdered him when he returned home and he's in the underworld, he praises Penelope and says, men will make songs about her, in times to come, and she almost becomes, the hero of the poem herself, and in many ways she is, and a lot of the recent scholarship on the Odyssey is about, it's feminist scholarship, is about Penelope and her metis, which is the Greek word for this cunning kind of intelligence that Odysseus and his wife share. So the poem has been interpreted in many ways throughout the millennia. The Neoplatonist philosophers saw Odysseus as the type of rational man wandering through the sublunary universe, acquiring gnosis, some kind of enlightenment, and finally returning to his celestial home. And it is a poem about experience and what you do with your experience. How do you use your experience in your life as it is now?
There is the whole tradition, of course, you spoke of the Neoplatonists, the Porphyry and Iamblichus on down to Proclus. There's this tradition of reading this. These are late classical philosophers.
Later classical.
Very late classical philosophers at the end of the classical age. And they're going to read this book, these books by Homer as entirely allegorical, speaking about the highest metaphysical propositions in allegorical terms. I don't think we have to go that far to help the caller out, though. And say that there is a religious theme here, and I think it's actually slightly different from the one Christopher Hitchens was pointing out, because it's clear all the way through. Your mention of Agamemnon, in fact, is worth picking up. There are two other stories that run through this Odyssey, which is, of course, all about Odysseus, but there are two other stories that keep popping up, and one, of course, is the Trojan War, and the other is Agamemnon's return. At every new location, they sit around and tell one another great stories, and one of the stories is always the story of Agamemnon. So Telemachus hears it twice, Odysseus hears it four times. It continually reappears, and that's a story of what happens when the homecoming goes wrong, when the wife is not faithful. That's the alternative that Odysseus could have faced. They do live in a world in which they're only, you know, a one-inch plank from falling into the bottom of the ocean. They live in a world of enormous violence and enormous caprice, and yet somehow they don't actually live in a mental world of that. They don't believe that the gods are necessarily capricious. They don't believe that things happen randomly. They have a sense of justice in the universe. They have a sense that good deeds will be rewarded and bad deeds will be punished. They live in a religious mind. And the world that they live in this dangerous way is somehow a reinforcement of that religious mind that they dwell within.
Well, not as constantly as you think, though, I think, because I was also going to ask Professor Lombardo this. You say, I don't know if I've guessed this right, but at one point your translation has, "Some wanderer, he was born to sorrow," and I suddenly thought, as again I had before in reading other translations, that it's not unlike the Book of Job in some way, and man is born to trouble as the sparks fly upward. And poor old Odysseus is a plaything, in many ways, of, you know, a god who decides to see how much he can take. But unlike Job, I don't think he's ever quite tempted to complain or to say, "Why is this happening to me? Why have you chosen me for these tribulations?" But the price of it, which Jody elides a little, is constant propitiation. You're always having to make sacrifices. You're always having to look for auguries and omens, always having to wonder if you've done the right thing or placated. Right, it's quite a servile existence a lot of the time. You're always in fear and dread and always wondering what exaction is going to be demanded of you or what humiliation you're going to have to inflict upon yourself.
Plano, Texas.
In that respect, very, very, very religious text.
Plano, Texas, you're next.
Good afternoon. I'm a first-time caller to C-SPAN. I'm delighted to get on. I'm so honored to talk with this brilliant panel. And I teach at a college in Plano, and of course I teach the Odyssey. There are so many themes in it that you've already touched upon, loyalty and recklessness, and a couple of things come to mind. I can discuss with my students all of these wonderful themes, and I agree with Mr. Bottom about virtue and nobility. But when I zero in on the notion of how does one live one's life when a war is over, and how reputation is so important with the notion of Telemachus learning you're a person of great, your father was of great renown, and so forth. This is where my students' eyes just shined. And I'd like to hear some commentary on that. And then from Mr. Christopher Hitchens, who's so brilliant, I admire you so much. Politically, a rascal like Bill Clinton, well, actually, I'm being kind, with someone like Odysseus, who is manipulative and, well, I won't go there. You know what kind, I mean, I think he's wonderful. He is heroic. But how do you reconcile some of his less than noble virtues to get home with a figure like Bill Clinton, or even the recklessness of the suitors? May I hang on and listen?
Thank you.
I think you're first.
Oh, no, I think you have the more important question.
Well, you know, it was said, I forget by whom, that the experience of warfare for men is like the experience of childbirth for women. That there's something essential about it, something basic. Men will always feel meanly about themselves if they haven't been exposed to a risk, if they haven't endangered themselves or been given and perhaps taken the opportunity to be heroic. And I have never been in combat, but I have been in war zones, and I remember actually thinking at one point, well, so this is what it's like, and I'm not as frightened as I thought I was going to be. I'm feeling as if I'd almost grown an inch. I'm feeling, but this is ignoble in a way. It's the sort of thing that makes people tend to glorify war and violence, but definitely realizing I wasn't exempt from this kind of thing. Since you have to mention the ignoble, contemptible figure of the man who, even as we speak, is still incredibly president, but not for many more days.
And the cover of your recent book.
I suppose that anything you could say is that here's someone who probably would be immune to such promptings, who simply doesn't have any emotions that aren't to do with his own self-interest and can't conceive of someone who's completely hollow and nihilistic. You can see it sometimes when he has to do ceremonial events, sometimes involving the burial of dead warriors. Words like honor and grandeur and nobility and so on are used, and he stands there looking as if he's saying to himself, I know I've heard these words before. What expression am I supposed to put on my face when they're being said? I'm sure there must be an apt mask I could wear. It's awful to dilate further upon, actually.
Well, let me bring that back to the problem that I have with Professor Lombardo's translation here. The problem that it seems to me that we face in this culture is not how despicable low culture can be, the pornography and the rest of it. The real problem is how low high culture is, that there's no alternative out there. You spoke of this being a book that could bring you in. And it may well be, but that the price of that is that it doesn't actually offer you an alternative. This is a teacher who's got these students, and she wants to talk to them, and she says their eyes will light up if she talks to them about nobility, if she talks to them about bravery, if she talks to them about virtue. Now, the real problem then is to find a voice in which to do that. Homer had it for his culture, this long hexameter line. He had a voice that was going to do this, and they could understand why people would speak these long speeches to each other. I had a friend who was a classicist once, and he said, you know, Latinist, however, not a Grecian, and he said, you know, he'd teach these modern students, and they could understand perfectly well why the Romans would spend time in orgies. They couldn't understand at all why they'd all troop down to the law courts to hear Cicero speak.
But I don't see how this in its original form is going to do that. It's not going to make sense to it's Shakespeare. People have such an incredibly hard time with Shakespeare, and that's more modern than this in its original. And to hear it declaimed, or even worse, hearing it would be easier than trying to read it and grapple with it on your own. I think there's a lot to be said for purism, and I tend to be one for things that I grew up with and love. I didn't grow up with this and love it, so I'm, of course, more amenable to monkeying around with it, but don't touch Dickens, you know. but you're not going to get me, you will now, because I'll have this to read the stuff in the original, and I think the average person, that's why it's good that people take these things in schools, because you can sort of go through it with your professor, and they'll give you a section, which is how I learned to make Shakespeare read. And again, I'm a person who loves books and has been reading serious literature since I was 4 or 5 years old, but not this. And Shakespeare, I had to be led by the hand with, and modern movies helped, modern updated translations, because I really wanted to go there. So I just can't help believing, without translations like this, you'll have a small, loyal following who gets it and who can go there with the nobility and the grand themes, but not a large, amenable following. So you have to choose. You have to decide.
Isn't it surprising, though, that I'm talking to the lady's point now about honor and nobility and glory and so forth, that unlike, say, the elegy of Pericles on the Peloponnesian War about, you know, the virtues of the city that fought it and the worthiness of the cause that it was fought concerning, there's no attempt to prepare people to review this war, the Trojan War, as a noble war. It's not fought in self-defense, it's actually fought for aggression and conceit and plunder. No one says this is a grand item, a grand issue, a grand matter for which a good man ought to be prepared to lay his life. It doesn't say what this teaches you is that there are some things worth fighting for, as many such narratives do. There's no attempt to do that. On the way back to Ithaca, why do they fight? They fight because they've run into another group of people who might be hostile to them. They're not even fighting any particular enemy. They're just fighting. And their enemies are very Protean. And we only have their word for it, that some of them were evil and some of them were just in the way.
But
it's quite surprising
that you
think there is no... It's not like the speech before Agincourt. It's not like, you know, I would not die in that man's company.
But neither is the March of the 10,000 out of Persia all the way back to Greece, which is much later.
No, but that's right, more like Dunkirk. It's a heroic escape.
Right, but it's the same. They're fighting people that just they're encountering on the way, because this is 10,000 mercenary Greek soldiers who went down to Persia to fight with Cyrus and lost, and then they had to get home. And essentially they had to fight their way all the way home, holding camp meetings every third or fourth day to argue about things. The story's been called Democracy on the March.
Where's the nobility? The nobility is once the fighting has begun.
The nobility, though, can't be then entirely, this is like what I take Christopher's point to be, the nobility can't be entirely in the nobility of the war then. Virtue is a much more personal thing. Peoples don't have virtue. This isn't like America fighting the Great Crusade of World War II, or England fighting World War II, or, you know, the peoples of Europe fighting the Crusades. It's not the war itself, which is necessarily the noble thing, for it must needs be that war will come. They live in that kind of world. What it is the nobility of the individual. That you can keep your honor in a world filled with violence, rage, war, mountains suddenly forming around your city, these things that can happen.
Let's get to another caller, Phoenix, Arizona.
Yes, I'm dying to hear what the Iliad and the Odyssey might have to say about the traditional roles of men and women then in Greek individualistic kind of male-dominated times versus how more, I think, domesticated societies where political correctness doesn't want our men to show too much competitive spirit or individualism. It's almost a matriarchal socialism versus a patriarchal capitalism.
Professor?
Well, the Odyssey has a great deal to say about the power relationships between men and women. Odysseus is alternately thwarted by powerful female figures. He's able to win some of them over to his side, and he's also aided by many women. Athena is the goddess who supports the male enterprise, if you will, supports, you know, these aristocratic male patriarchal values. She likes men, she likes heroes, she likes soldiers, she likes intelligent men, especially, and that's why she likes Odysseus so much. She even likes him because he's a liar. And he's very good at it. And she really admires him for that. At one point, she says, "Well, here we are, the two shrewdest minds in the universe. You know, I'm, you know, famed among the gods, you know, for my clever stratagems, and you among men." At the same time, one of the themes that really runs throughout the Odyssey is expressed by the Greek word homophrosyne, which means like-mindedness. And Odysseus actually first brings it up when he's talking to the princess, Nausicaa, who is rescuing him. And he washes ashore her island, Phaeacia, and he has nothing. He's absolutely destitute. And he makes a very winning speech to her. She's a young girl out, princess, doing the laundry. He talks to her about perhaps the marriage that's on her mind. And he says, you know, there's nothing better in this life than like-mindedness, homophrosyne, between a man and a woman, a husband and a wife. And one way to read the Odyssey is this successive appearance or growth of homophrosyne. When we first meet Odysseus, he's with Calypso, and they are not like-minded at all. He still slept with her in her caverns, an unwilling lover mated to her eager embrace, days he spent sitting on the sea, staring out at the breakers with hollow, salt-rimmed eyes. They just had no meeting of minds, and finally he leaves. When he's with Circe,
not without a final encounter with her.
Oh, he sleeps with her once more.
Well, the sex is good. Yes, it's just everything else is out.
No, that's fine.
Yeah.
It's very beautiful, actually, the last time they go to bed. But then when he's with Circe, you sense, these people are thinking alike in some way. He spends very willingly a year with her as opposed to 7 unwilling years with Calypso. And then when he comes finally home and disguised as a beggar, has encounters with Penelope, it's really fascinating to see how their minds are starting to come together after 20 years, or have always been together. And when she thinks of this strategy of the contest with the bow to determine whom she will marry, it seems that she's doing that in some sort of recognition of who this beggar is, although they are not overtly recognizing each other. He for his purposes, and she perhaps out of her fears. But their minds come closer and closer until finally the great recognition scene, the very beautiful and noble recognition scene between them when husband and wife finally come together after 20 years. You can see that they are supporting each other. And that the gender struggle has finally been resolved when finally they do go to bed together, to their bed and to their rituals of old, is how Homer very tactfully and nobly puts it.
Isn't it to Nausicaa that he says, imagining this possible wedding,
yes,
that there's nothing greater than the toast at a nuptial, that this couple will be a great joy to their friends and a great grief to their enemies.
Yes.
Isn't that, I always thought that was, I don't want to seem too matey, but I was actually at Deborah's wedding and thought to myself it would be wonderful to be able to give this toast, but maybe too early to say.
May you be a joy to your friends and have no enemies.
Right. Well, Professor Lombardo just gave us a brilliant analysis, it seems to me. The only thing I'd want to add is to answer directly to the speaker or to the telephone caller and say there's a sense in which this whole analysis of the social world and society, there is no social world. There is no society. There's politics and there's private life. But this whole kind of social world and the way society oppresses us and all the rest of it, it really didn't exist for the Greeks in the way that we conceive it now. So that you read these about these people, and sometimes they're like children. They really are, just like children. And other times they're like adults, so much older than you are, so much wiser. The men and the women seem actually grown-ups. Sometimes when you're reading this, they're grown-ups about sex, they're grown-ups about private life, and then you see Telemachus get up in the meeting on the islands, and you see him speaking, and you realize that once again their political lives are the political lives of grown-ups as well. They're living in a different world, and this whole sort of social question of what different societies do and how individuals are over against their society and oppressed or free, all of those are kind of modern questions that the Greeks couldn't have conceived of at all. That's what makes them sometimes seem childish.
Right.
But then the rest of the time, it makes them seem like grown-ups. So you see Penelope and Odysseus talking, and they are full-grown, clear-eyed, intelligent, wise people.
Also to the question about the feminine and masculine principle, I mean, we aren't really made privy to how Penelope feels about what choice she had in being abandoned for a war in which she doesn't appear to have any direct interest or need. But we are told something in general about how civilians are in as much danger as soldiers in these kinds of battles. And so a man has really the privilege of having volunteered for it. But what happens to women if their menfolk are killed or if their side loses is made very explicit indeed.
Right. Although
and
the
in
tradition.
The same way the masculine and the feminine principle is represented by Athena, who's undoubtedly, as you say, the moral and intellectual victor of the arbitrament, and who is wise and thoughtful and takes the long view, whereas Poseidon, who's as masculine as you could wish, acts all the time as if he's having premenstrual tension.
Although the tradition, of course, once these descended into these two epics descended in the next generations, other epics were written to kind of fill in the missing pieces of the story. And in those, you can find the tradition that, in fact, Odysseus was not a volunteer. He didn't want to go and feigned madness in attempt to get out of going. Mm. But it is finally, of course, his honor is at stake, finally. He finally does have to go. Once they put, in fact, in the tradition, he pretends madness and he pretends to be plowing. And so they take the baby Telemachus and put him in front of the plow. And Odysseus stops, and then right. that's how they know he's not crazy. And now, since he's sane, he's got to fulfill his duty and go to war.
It's catch-22. You'd have to be crazy to want to go.
Yes,
exactly. But if you know you're crazy, then you can't be crazy. But, I'm sorry. I just have to say to the caller, if any woman who would volunteer to go back and live in these times, just for the sake of having clarity in gender roles, she's welcome to it. But, you know, this woman has to marry. She can't choose to remain single. She can't make that choice, either her father or her son is going to make that choice, or these men are going to make it for her, these men who have invaded her home and won't leave. There's no way they interpreted their world the way we're interpreting their world, just as people 1,000 years from now will look at our world and slice and dice it completely differently. But I think she certainly knew. She didn't say, I stand my ground as an individual, sovereign human being, and I refuse to get married. She came up with subterfuge after subterfuge. So she did the best she could in the world that she was living in. And nobody had a great shake in this life. So it's not that women were worse off. You can't really make those sorts of you can't make a hierarchy of. Everything depended on how wealthy you were, how beautiful you were, how favored by the gods you seemed to be. If you were a man, were you big and strong and godlike, or were you this wimpy guy who couldn't shoot a bow and arrow? Life was nasty, brutish, and short. But I still wouldn't have chosen to be a woman in that world.
Indeed, when Athena appears to Telemachus and says, resist this idea that your mother should be forced to choose one of the suitors, one of the reasons that she gives for that being inconvenient is that her parents would have to pay Penelope's parents, a whole new dowry, they have to go through all that again to get her married off again. So
but it isn't nasty.
Instead of saying, I can appear to you as a shower of gold and take care of that, which is in her power to do.
Exactly. But here's the point of this story is actually, I'm so glad you used that phrase of Thomas Hobbes, nasty, brutish, and short, which was his description of human life. Because the point of the Odyssey is in fact to tell another version of human existence. It's to tell the version of human existence that human existence is brutish, short, and glorious. That it's the alternative to the Hobbesian vision.
Well, it can be for some people.
Well, okay, but you're supposed.
Glorious life is worth an age.
Right. So that you're this 14-year-old girl. You know, you're out there washing the clothes, even though your father owns the palace. You still got to go out and wash the clothes.
I thought that was interesting.
Right, because in fact, you know, there isn't this enormous gap in what they have to do between the wealthy and the poor. You notice even Helen there. She has her golden footstool, and what she's doing? She's winding yarn. Everybody works, but you're a 14-year-old girl. You're out there. They're bleaching the sheets, and this gorgeous full-grown man appears before you, wily as all get out, and he says, oh, are you a goddess or a human being? And she says,
he was a player.
Oh, please come home to my father's house.
Living Taylor, you're next.
Thank you. I'm enjoying this panel very much. My question was kind of build off of some of the earlier comments about the distinction between the modern way of taking some of the things that Odysseus and Homer, things that happened to Odysseus and Homer, wrote about, and the ancient Greek way of looking at it. And specifically, my question is about what the panelists think about the notion of virtue, because it strikes me in a lot of ancient Greek literature that what they would mean by virtue or human excellence is quite a bit different than what we as moderns might think of it. Specifically, some of the earlier callers saying, trying to make a parallel between Odysseus and some of the things that's been happening politically with the Clinton administration strikes me as they might be talking across purposes, because what they take virtue to be, what we take virtue to be in the modern sense might be completely different from what the Greeks did.
Thanks, Bloomington. Professor, you must start on that?
Yes, we can begin with Odysseus's preeminent virtue. The Greek word is metis, a deep, complex word. I translated it as cunning, which I think is pretty close to the one word translation that most scholars would agree upon. So is cunning a virtue in our world? You know, Odysseus is an inveterate liar. He lies to survive. He has all of these false stories that he tells to various people about his origin and where he's been and what he's doing. Athena really admires him for this. Does he have to tell all of these lies? For instance, does he have to tell the final lie in the poem to his father. His old father is working in the fields. He doesn't know his son is back. Odysseus, after 20 years, comes up to him, and he thinks it over. He says, well, what should I do? Should I tell him straight out, who I am, or should I provoke him a little, test him, draw him out? Better to do that. And he tells his father this long lie about who he is and where he's from, and he almost seems to be enjoying giving the old man a hard time. What is he really doing there? Does he have to tell that lie? Does he have to tell all of these lies? Is that virtuous? On some islands I've read in Greece, peasant cities, perhaps communities that have been isolated for a while, lying is considered to be a tremendous virtue. If you really know how to tell a good lie, that's just great, And you're one up on someone.
Perhaps that's where Zeno's paradox of Crete comes from.
Yeah, the Cretan liar. All Cretans are liars, the Cretan said.
Yeah, we're it's good dialectic anyway.
Yeah, so there are differences in, we still have Plato's four, cardinal virtues, which I'm sure that you can rattle off. But they're not exactly the virtues that we find in the Homeric poems, I don't think. Odysseus is very ruthless. Does he have to kill all 108 suitors? Even those who, seem to have a pretty good excuse, for why they're there. I'm only their soothsayer, Leodes said. That's all I ever did. I didn't want to participate in any of this. And Odysseus says, if you were really their soothsayer, how many times must you have prayed that it would be you who my wife would go off with? You're a dead man. Very ruthless. The suitors make a good case. They say, look, we're going to replace anything that we touched here. All of the cattle, all of the wine, we'll make it good. We never touched Penelope. We really thought you were dead. It has been 20 years. Why did he kill all of them? So his ruthlessness, his apparent cruelty at times, the delight that he takes in lying. What about all of that? Does a hero have to be an entirely virtuous character? After all,
not only
or is Homer's mind a little more complex than that?
Well,
that we do move beyond, notions of nobility to extremely complex real people who might actually speak like real people and think like real people rather than be paradigms of virtue.
Well, but on your final exams, who gets an A? You must ask this question all the time. What do you have to say to get an A on your final exam on this question? It seems to me, in trying to figure this out, you can't look at a society that has slaves and say, well, no matter what this person did, they were ignoble. You can't do it that way because things change from time to time. What is the constant? What is the definition of virtue? Which it seems to me it has to be sort of separated from the day-to-dayness of the time that it exists. If, for instance, if a war is underlyingly, if it's only fought for booty and slaves and that sort of thing, can anything you do in service of that war be noble? And if the answer to that question is no, then nobody's wars were ever, World War II, Civil War, there is no such thing. So that can't be. How do you define these terms in a way that doesn't require a value judgment of the underlying circumstances? What is virtue?
Well, the Greek word for virtue is arete, which means excellence. The related word root you'd find in, say, aristocrat, aristocracy, is a Greek word that means really excelling, being the very best. So in the Iliad, for instance, if you speak well and fight well, you have arete. In the Odyssey, you also have to have patience, endurance, intelligence, commitment. These are the virtues, the fine qualities. That's really what virtue means in Greek, a fine quality, an excellent quality of character. But it is not defined. It certainly doesn't have the moral sense that our word virtue has. Christopher.
Well, I can't remember who said it, but it's said that of the cardinal virtues, that courage is not numbered among them, but it is the quality that makes the exercise of those virtues possible. And the thing you can say for Odysseus is that he's always willing to expose himself to danger or to any test of courage again, and never seeks to avoid confrontation. And even with the Phaeacians, when after he's had all their welcome, and though their bard has made him weep, he thinks, well, okay, now I'll challenge you to some games. You know, I may not look much. And someone, in fact, taunts him and says, you don't look as if you'd be any good at the athletic. So he says, well, I can put this discus, you know, far beyond your reach.
We can't expect, though, Christopher, that...
Pushing the envelope.
...that the virtues are going to be exactly the same. I mean, the great change comes with Christianity. Right? And it changes everything. It changes the virtues. I'm not sure how this could be, because fortitude is, or how courage could not be ranked among the virtues. At least fortitude is, which is a Christian form of virtue, of courage.
That could just be endurance, which is certainly exaggerated.
Well, actually, but courage is. I mean, the four classical virtues are courage, wisdom, sophrosyne, which is some kind of temperance, and justice. Those are the four Platonic virtues and the four
Stoics hand them on to the Christians.
Right. Bravery in the sense of something.
Right. Yeah, the word actually is andrea, manliness.
Manliness.
Everything that implies.
Well, yes. which virtue itself should imply.
I think it's the courage is TK, all the same.
Oakland, California.
Hello.
You're on the air.
Hi, this is Willis Barnstone. I've translated some books from ancient Greek.
I'm an admirer of your work.
Oh, thank you very much. I was going to say that I just turned into this wonderful program, and I'm going to go down to Cody's and buy your translation, Professor Lombardo. As far as the level of rhetoric, the register of rhetoric, just hearing you speak, I did feel it was appropriate to a picaresque hero who's surviving around the Mediterranean. I was very consoled when I heard Mr. Hitchens say parakalo to bring in the Greeks, as probably all should, the modern Greeks. I loved hearing you recite the words in ancient Greek, but as one who learned Greek, ancient and modern in Greece, I wish that the live language of ancient Greek would be spoken as we do in the Greek Orthodox Church or in the amphitheaters of Greece where you hear the ancient plays, because it makes it alive again. Maybe you would agree, but you do use the international Erasmian translation, but which is still a little unreal to me.
How many different translations are there?
There are over 50 translations of the Odyssey in English.
And in the critic?
In Greek, well, there are some modern translations. There's one, in fact, by Nikos Kazantzakis, who translated the Odyssey into modern Greek. Professor Barnstone prefers the modern Greek pronunciation. I use what we call the restored classical pronunciation. Scholars are pretty well informed. They've informed themselves at any rate. The Greeks didn't leave any, you know, cassette recordings or anything of the sort. But comparative linguistics and historical linguistics, very highly developed field, we're pretty sure we know what classical Greek sounded like. And it's something like as in my recitation. Although, if you'd like, I could do it in modern Greek.
your translation has been performed?
My translation of the, Book One of the Iliad has been performed by the Aquila Theater Company in Lincoln Center, New York, and toured the country last year. I understand that they're preparing a version of performance version of my translation of the Odyssey. I myself have done numerous performances of various sorts of both my Iliad and Odyssey throughout the country.
How many kids in your classics class at the University of Kansas?
Well, we enroll 500 every semester in Greek mythology, in which
in
we read
one classroom?
Texts. In one class, an auditorium class, as I play to the masses. then we have a number of other courses. We enroll a total of about 800 students a semester in our Greek and Latin and classical civilization courses.
But part of the Odyssey turns them on.
Well, the Odyssey is usually read in high school. Still, I think just the story of the Cyclops, you know, as an adventure story. I think students really do respond. Students at a university respond to the domestic side of the story. What does he do when he's back on Ithaca? How is he going to deal with these 108 suitors? How is he going to get back together with his wife? Will she ever recognize him? I think those are the parts of the story that have really universal appeal.
Professor Lombardo's cover of his translation of the Iliad has a photo from D-Day, World War II.
Yeah.
I understand this is a kind of a controversial cover.
I think most people like it, actually. Brian Rack, who's here today at the studio, is the editor at the press at Hackett Publishing Company, and we were wondering what kind of cover. We wanted to avoid any notion of a classical cliche, sort of statue or vase painting, you know, that sort of thing, and to have the cover announce the style and the urgency of this new translation. And we were sitting in a hotel room in Lawrence, Kansas, and we're thinking, we want a photograph, we want a black and white photograph, we want a black and white World War II photograph, and this became the inevitable cover. This war defines an era in our civilization in the way that the Trojan War and the Homeric epic, the Iliad, defined an era for the Greeks. So we thought it was a perfectly appropriate cover.
And Normandy launched 1,000 ships.
That's right, it's an amphibious assault.
Did you have a relationship with Greek scholars, Greek classical scholars? Do you all discuss the translations back and forth? Do you get any feedback from them?
Oh, of course. I do. Just read the back cover, the words.
I was in Athens once just after the fall of the military dictatorship in 1974. And there was a huge crowd in Syntagma Square, which is the main square in the Athens. The Syntagma means, for my demotic Greek is wrong, you'll correct me, but it means both regiment and also constitution, in other words, which actually was in a way the problem with Greece at the time. They couldn't distinguish between army and constitution. But this crowd was chanting something, and I was coming in on the wrong beat, like Salone's listener in Fontamara, till I finally found out what the beat was. They were saying catharsis, catharsis. I was coming in on this, catharsis. They wanted a purge of the state. They wanted to clean up. They wanted to throw out.
Yeah.
The old gang, and I suddenly thought, well, I absolutely know, now I've recognized the word, I can see what it must mean and what its relationship to Aristotle's Poetics is. And Aristotle said that Homer was, there was none finer, so we are able to make tenuous, genuine references. I think it is the oldest language we can use.
The critic George Steiner has an essay in which he points out that, or which he claims, I don't know with what accuracy, but it sounds right, that the translation of Homer into English is the translation act which has taken place more often than any other in the history of the world, more often than any one book has been translated into French or any one book translated into German or anything else. The single act of translation that's been done most often in the world is the translation of Homer's Greek into English. And it gives us, of course, bookshelves full of different translations. T. Lawrence says, Lawrence of Arabia did a prose translation of it that I have here, in which he says he wrote a letter to his publisher saying he was uniquely qualified to do this because he had used a bow, he had sailed the Aegean, and he had killed many men. And that actually gave him the wherewithal to do this. But, you know, when he was writing this, said there were 28, and of course he's wrong, there were 58 by that point. So. What's interesting is that everybody feels, I think as Professor Lombardo feels, that nobody's quite gotten it right yet. And maybe if we just did it again, we could get it right now. And yet Homer is always one step beyond us. He's like Plato in this way, or Shakespeare. You always think that you're going to have a theory that's going to get it for you. And the trouble is, of course, that the text is so much deeper than your theory. The text, in fact, interprets your theory rather than lets the theory interpret the text.
It's not a matter of getting it right, but of bringing it alive again, and certainly not making it into a museum piece or embalming it in any way. It's almost as if the poems themselves call for new translation. You might think that a poet translator such as myself would decide to translate the Iliad and the Odyssey. And in fact, I fell in love with these poems when I was 19 years old, reading Homer's Greek for the first time in an elementary Greek course. And as soon as I heard and was able to recite the first line of the Odyssey, I knew I wanted to do this. But then it took 40 years, just about, to actually get it done. And it's almost as if it wasn't my choice, that it came through me. And the way that, Christopher, you were saying before, the bard
is a ventriloquist in yes. some way. And the process of translation is, remembering.
Or an oracle, I suppose, would be.
Pardon me?
Or an oracle.
Or an oracle. It's remembering your voice, and I'm remembering the voice of our generation, our post-Vietnam War generation, the last 25 years, the living languages and the rhythms of our living language. And that's the language that I'm trying to bring Homer alive.
Florence, Kansas.
Hi, Stan. It's Susie.
Hi, Susie. How are you?
I'm pretty good.
Who are you, Susie?
I'm a good friend of Stan's and Lauren's. I'm 13 years old. Just so you all know, because you laughed at that 15-year-old.
Oh, we weren't laughing. Have you read the Odyssey or the Iliad?
I am very interested in Greek mythology. I have been studying it since I was like in fourth grade, but we don't discuss it really a lot at school. But I read it a lot at home. But my question was, what was the relationship between Odysseus and the soldiers? It kind of concerns the Iliad and the Odyssey. So, yeah.
Which soldiers?
Like the soldiers on the ship and the Iliad, that when they were on the island, all trapped and fighting. So.
Professor?
Well, Odysseus had his 12 ships, and each ship had a crew of 20 or 30 men. This was his fighting force during the Trojan War. He was responsible for all of these men and tried to bring them all back home safely, but he was unable to do so. And this is brought up in the opening lines of the poem. He failed to bring his crew home. Hard as he tried, they were destroyed by their own recklessness. He really loved some of his crew members and cared for all of them and did his best by them, but in the end was unable to bring them home. He's well aware of this, and the poet himself seems a little nervous about it. What kind of hero is this who loses all of his men? What kind of commander is this? And then when he comes home, he kills the flower of the next generation. So two entire generations of the best and brightest in Ithaca are wiped out by Odysseus. So that's his relation to these young men.
Seattle, Washington.
Yes.
You're on the air, ma'am.
Hello.
Go ahead.
Well, I was just wondering how it's possible to interpret about the Clinton's life. I mean, for all we know, Hillary is his Penelope, but I really didn't get to hear very well the comparison about honor, courage, that with this great work and Clinton's act as a politician here. And maybe I misheard that there was, maybe there, that I heard that there was some mentioning about too much mention of the private life of the Clintons and the fine quality of their life and whether they're virtuous or not. And that's my question.
Mr. Hitchens.
Mrs. Clinton doesn't have 108 suitors either. No, I think I'll let it go. I think I'll pass on that.
Anybody else? Jackson, Mississippi.
Hello.
You're on the air, ma'am.
Yes. Connie. We adore you. You're a wonderful commentator. Mr. Hitchens, I've written you a letter once a long time ago. I've watched you on C-SPAN and been fascinated with you. But, you know, I've had to study. I went to an Episcopal private school here in the United States, and I had to study the Iliad and Odyssey and like that. And truly, I really believe, being a charismatic, tongue-talking Christian today, that these four classical virtues, the Greek mythology, that so many students spend so much time studying these things, and where is it really advancing our society? And I really think that, I really resent, I'm sorry, I'm getting feedback here. I resent every dollar, taxpayer dollar, that goes to propel these the classics, really, because I don't see that it really helps us. And I think that there's so much more, even today on C-SPAN, there's so much going on politically in Mississippi that we need to discuss. Like, we have the National Chamber of Commerce there in Washington is trying to take over our Supreme Court elections. We have an elected Supreme Court here. And, you know, we're not getting these discussions underway. And it just seems like the classics, well and good, but I really think that we need to restructure our entire educational system. I think that a lot of the things that we spend time on is a waste of time and not really furthering humanity.
Thanks, Jackson.
Well, as far as I understand that, and I must say it was very incoherently and poorly expressed, I would say that you're creating a false antithesis. Whatever might be wrong with your relations with the Chamber of Commerce and your Supreme Court wouldn't be cured by less study of the classics in school. One doesn't detract from the other. Insofar as the classics should, and in fact do, whether you care about it or not, play a role in education, it would be simply this. If you don't know something about classical Greece, then you won't be able, with much profit, to read Shakespeare or Milton or Shelley or Keats or even Chaucer. I mean, it would be like not knowing what the Bible story was and then wondering how you'd puzzle your way through Shakespeare as well. It's part of the underlay, it's part of the common heritage.
Sure.
Not just of ideas and metaphors and characters and a stock of references, which is essential for anyone who wants to try and teach, is to be able to make a reference that everyone will get.
Surely it's even stronger than that. If we don't preserve a world in which we can read Homer, then the world isn't worth preserving.
But Deborah Dickerson has lived X number of years, we won't say how many.
21
years without reading Homer. You have a new book out, you're a journalist.
But I am heavily reliant and I think indebted as a thinking person and an artistic person, beauty-loving person, to the canon, the Eurocentric canon, a phrase I didn't even know until I was in my 20s, because I didn't know I was, my education was,
too.
Well, no, it's real. I mean, there's Europe and there's other places. And I love the Eurocentric canon. I just wish I hadn't had to teach myself about the rest of the things that there are to love in this world. I do think that, you know, there are other cultures write books and have stories and that sort of thing, and I had to discover those on my own. But that doesn't mean I wish that I hadn't been exposed to Greek and Roman myths and English literature and that sort of thing. And I do think there's something to this notion of cultural literacy, and I do think there's something to this notion of a common heritage. I think it's too circumscribed. But I went to Greece on my honeymoon last year, a year ago, and like it or not, and I'm a very political person, like it or not, it's part of us. We would be driving down the road, and with no thought that I was going to say this, I'd look up, see columns, and go, Corinthian, Ionian, Doric. I don't know where I learned that. We went to Marathon, and it starts playing in my head the story of the battle and the runner sent to spread the news. We went to Delphi, which is, I find, one of the most moving places. And I was trying not to be moved by Greece, you know, and dead white men, you know, who needs it? But you cannot look at the Parthenon and not be moved. And to read, I spent the entire time reading the fattest, thickest guidebook that had the story of the Peloponnesian Wars and all these sorts of things. There's no reason you can't know this and know lots of other things too. There's beauty and wonder here, and there's character and human foible. This is far from a simple story. It's far from a one-dimensional, the Greeks are wonderful story. Nobility and virtue are complicated notions, and the best way to divine them and puzzle through them is with a complicated story. So I don't understand why you can't be concerned about the Mississippi State Supreme Court and Homer.
Once again, I think it's, you want to put it even, or I would want to put it even more strongly than that. The reason we can have this argument, the reason actually I don't just say this is, as Professor Lombardo, I actually think Professor Lombardo's translation is brilliant and funny and fast-moving. It's a great book. But the reason that we're having this argument, that I think it's important to have the argument, is because it's the most important thing in the world, except maybe fulfilling one's religious duty. What else is there that's worth arguing?
One with the question.
No, but she wants, I'm sorry, arguing about what the Chamber of...
As a charismatic Pentecostalist, I challenge her to a debate in any tongue she cares to name.
I'm sorry, arguing about the Chamber of Commerce is not fulfilling one's religious duty.
No, but explain to me how this is the most...
I think what we could tell them was people were saying that if it's not in the Bible, who needs it? That's actually what we were...
Oh, she wasn't saying that.
I had a feeling there was that.
Ah, well, then I missed that. And even so, you know, what we have here is the great work of literature. We've got the best poet who ever lived. This is what Professor Lombardo said.
But how could we win that contest? I mean... You know, who held that contest? So I don't know whether we have to go there.
No, I think
we don't have to go there.
I don't think you do either. You can say the first poet who ever lived.
The first recorded poet.
The first poet.
Surviving poet.
It's the origin of poetry. We don't have to say necessarily it's the best.
But you're saying that both of these things can exist on an equal plane. The follow-up question then would be, but what can you learn from the Odyssey that can be used in questions like she's asking, the political questions of today?
And it's a way, what I'm trying to say is the question, if you even have to ask the question, poetry has already ceased to matter. If it doesn't seem obvious that poetry is simply a superior human activity, it's something that human beings do to understand themselves, and it is as high a reach toward understanding themselves as they have ever accomplished. If you don't already see that, then you're entered into the sort of argument, well, why should the, as Kipling would put it, you know, why should British examiners for entrance into the War College give thousands of marks for knowledge of Shakespeare and Latin? You know, what good is that to them? Well, as soon as you ask that question, what good is that to them, you've already lost. And the world has narrowed and gotten dull in color.
It's a utilitarian question.
Reno, Nevada.
Hi, Professor Lombardo. I think it's absolutely fabulous that you're bringing the classics alive, especially in places, you know, like in the Midwest and Kansas. And here's my question. I have an old classics dropout. I just think it's wonderful whenever anybody brings up the classics to college students. My question is this, not so much on a literal level, but do you think that the Odyssey in some way is an enactment or a reflection on Greek models of justice or injustice? And as kind of a follow-up, in what way do you think the Odyssey could be read in a modern world as a kind of model of justice or injustice?
Well, I've been alluding to this question, I think, various comments earlier. Is Odysseus just in killing all 108 suitors? Does he really have to do that? Certainly everyone would agree that the suitors have transgressed. They have violated the laws of hospitality, which would constitute an entire set of virtues, and a very important set of virtues in the ancient world. So I think the question of justice is very important in the Odyssey, but I think there is certainly a larger issue. And actually, in answering your question, I would continue the previous conversation. Certainly, tradition is important, and cultural literacy, and I think poetry has a nearly supreme value for human beings. I think the real reason to read a poem such as the Odyssey and also the Iliad, Homer's other great work, is Homer's mind. To quote Matthew Arnold again, he said of Homer, he saw life steadily and he saw it whole. Homer almost never passes judgment on anything explicitly or implicitly. He sees war itself. The Iliad contains radical critiques of war. But Homer sees war, various forms of human behavior that we can barely tolerate anymore if we really look at it. The savagery of the universe represented in the cannibalistic Laestrygonians and the Cyclops, all of that is just as it is. Seeing things steadily and seeing them whole, seeing this world just as it is. And that turns out to be the mind of great compassion. I sense throughout the Homeric poems a deep compassion for this world, for the human condition. And I think that is the ultimate reason for reading works such as this. Not the light that they may cast on certain questions or certain questions that they may bring to light, but the very deep, very wide, very clear, deeply compassionate mind of the poet Homer.
Lafayette, Louisiana.
Hi, what a marvelous discussion and a marvelous panel. I once wrote a paper in college on elements of existentialism in the Iliad, and I remember writing at the time that I thought the fact that we view these things through the lens of Christianity was not legitimate because it was anachronistic. Now, what made me think that it was legitimate to write about existentialism because of that, I don't know, but but you know, hindsight is 20/20. But my question is, given that we've received this, you know, after 2,000 years of the Christian experience, is it a legitimate lens through which to view the Homer's works? And if not, then how do we come close I'm sort of revisiting, I guess, the issue of virtue. How do we come close to understanding what Homer means if we don't use that schema?
Jody Bottom?
You know, the closest anybody got, I suppose, to the kind of reading that it sounds like she was doing was the great French mystic of the 20th century, Simone Weil, who wrote a brilliant, utterly brilliant, utterly nutty critique of Homer.
Beautiful report.
Yeah, exactly, but just so wrong.
Well, I don't know if it was so wrong.
But it is a beautiful, it's beautiful, and yet somehow you just don't understand Homer ever in it. But the problem, of course, is that the virtues have shifted. Now, someone like Alistair MacIntyre, a contemporary philosopher, has written perhaps the most talked about book of philosophy in the last 50 years, a book called After Virtue. And his claim is finally, all of the virtue words are empty. We're living at a time in which we've still got all them like markers, but they're like checks on accounts that you've closed. You can't write on them anymore. You can say, oh, we should all be courageous, and nobody knows what you're talking about. During the Gulf War, some Spanish troops were assigned, who joined the coalition a little bit late, were assigned to drive trucks. And the Spanish general complained that his troops had been denied the honor of battle. And he was crucified for this in the media, by the high command, by everybody. And he was also using the word honor in a way that Homer would understand, right? So that the word there becomes, but then of course you heard General Schwarzkopf, you heard everybody else use the word honor, so if it didn't mean what it meant clearly for the Spanish general, what did it mean when General Schwarzkopf spoke about honor? It didn't mean what Homer did. Well, at least, even if MacIntyre's wrong, what he's pointing to is a world where those virtue words are still drawn on an account of meaning. Right? They're still written on a banking account that's full. This is where I took most exception to what you said, when you said this isn't a simplistic account of, or this isn't a simplistic virtue here, a virtuous man, a simplistic account. What Homer gives us is a world in which we're not faced with that dichotomy, where there's the simplistic, stupid virtue stuff, and then there's the more complex human stuff. As though that were the divide. He lives in a world in which virtue itself is complex, in which the virtues themselves are interrelated and awkwardly composed. When Aristotle writes the Nicomachean Ethics, he gives a list of some of the virtues, and he includes, for instance, among them, luck. Now, the idea that luck could be a virtue, right?
That's what Bonaparte used to ask of his general.
Right, exactly. I want you to be as lucky.
Any one officer like quality looking for, which is luck.
But the fact that we could hear that and think luck, virtue, those words just don't go together, is proof that the virtue world that they're living in here has been fundamentally changed by Christianity, maybe finally emptied by Christianity. That these heroic virtues, although Christianity took them over and redirected the honor of them. The honor in for the Greeks is you get the, you know, if you're a virtuous man, you mean you're courageous, you're strong, you're wily, you're lucky, you get the good things. You get the money and you get the pretty women. But, you know, for a Christian, this is the same thing. If you're virtuous, if you have the theological virtues of faith, hope, and charity, if you have the four cardinal virtues, if you that, you get the good things, except the good thing has changed, the good thing is heaven. Right? It's only the reward has changed. But the end result, it seems to me, after 2,000 years of having that change take place, is the words themselves are finally emptied. If the culture doesn't believe in heaven, Christianity killed off our ability to see the old rewards as the honors for virtue. And if the culture has ceased to believe in heaven, then we no longer have any reward at all for virtue, and the words themselves become empty.
But there'll be a lot of attempts. Gladstone made one, Dante made one, to try and assimilate the great Greek epics to Christianity and to make them look as if they were sort of pre-Christian but prefigured ideas of the same dilemmas, which I think are all doomed to fail. The only thing they have in common is that it becomes very clear indeed from reading the Odyssey that in contrast to what the Bible teaches us, God did not make man in his own image, man made gods in his own image. These are anthropomorphic gods. They are invented by us, as all gods are. That's indisputable. The other element that I think is, which I'm surprised you didn't touch on, is that Odysseus doesn't really have free will. Things happen to him the tests he undergoes are tests of fortitude, of endurance, of how will he take it. But the idea that he can be the master of his fate or the captain of his soul is quite absent. It isn't really his fault. He's the plaything of other forces,
right.
And
his
including
crew
of
opens the bag and lets the wind out.
The alien winds release. Which is where
right.
Jesus puts evil spirits.
Right. But I'd have to disagree with your analysis. I mean, if the old classical virtues don't hold up and the society no longer believes in heaven, I think it's chauvinistic to assume that one needs to be a Christian to be virtuous or to aspire to it. I mean, Christians are not a majority on the planet, and yet there are people in other cultures who certainly have notions of, and in our own, I'm not a Christian, but I, you know, adhere to notions of virtue and nobility, and you look for them where you can find them. What I can from Christianity, I take what I can from literature, I take what I can from
right.
history.
But one of the things we're reaching for is that you can't take what you want from Christianity and from Homer because they're not reconcilable. That you're going to make a mishmash if you do that. But here's the other thing. I'm not sure that it is true that any other culture than Western culture has a concept of virtue. Because virtue itself, what we mean, this is a social construct. It's something that was given to us. It's a way of understanding the world that we inherited. If you go to other cultures to look for virtues in any meaningful sense of that word, you're looking for Western-style things in them.
But they have, Buddhists, Hindus don't have notions of superior behavior as opposed to inferior behavior. Maybe they don't use the word virtue, but
here's
clearly.
Here's a good example, justice. We said, you asked the question, is it justice that the 108 suitors die? Your very ability to ask that question means that you've lived through a Christian era, right? And also probably come to the end of it. Because, of course, it is justice that they die. It's poetic justice. It's the justice of the story.
That's a question Socrates would be perfectly capable of asking and of considering. Christianity has added exactly nothing to our consideration of what is virtuous. Absolutely nothing at all.
Mercy?
All it's added is
supernatural
reinforcements. No faith, hope, and charity. No, a lot of these are filched from early Judaism, and many of them are. And it's an acknowledged indebtedness, furthermore, because otherwise, why would so many Christians, like Gladstone and Dante, go back all the time to try and prove that the extreme sensitivity to matters of ethics in classical Greece were such as to make Christianity superfluous? They had to say no. It's a prefiguration of it. It's what.
I just can't accept that. The tale.
Virgil shows
the parable of the prodigal son would be unintelligible to Homer. It would be unintelligible to.
As it is.
Right. It would be unintelligible to say that if you're not a Christian.
It says that selfishness and greed and taking no thought for the morrow are rewarded. It's an amoral story. The parable of the prodigal son.
Well, then this is what Professor Lombardo was talking about.
Because
he's talking
is
about
in itself amoral.
The moralized
it depends on
world.
Vicarious redemption. It's scapegoating. It's simply throwing your sins onto another and punishing him or her. It's traditional desert culture scapegoating.
Professor, we're going to
morally a huge step backwards.
Professor, we're going to ask you to get ready to perform one more time for us. Something from the Odyssey while we take our next call from the Hinesville, Georgia.
Hi, my name's Daniel, and I graduated with a degree in classics 1 or 2 years ago, and I have a question for Professor Lombardo.
Where did you go to school first? Tell us where you went to school.
Davidson College.
And where is that?
Charlotte, North Carolina.
Okay, go ahead.
And I was wondering, I have a question about Homer's relationship to the philosopher Nietzsche. I was wondering if Professor Lombardo sees any specifically Homeric influences on Nietzsche's moral philosophy. And what influences that might have had on cultural moral development since Nietzsche's time?
Well, I'm not prepared to answer that question. I avoid Nietzsche like the plague.
Why?
Myself. I just never could read more than 1 or 2 pages. Don't know why. So we'll have to pass that on.
Christopher Hitchens, I'm sure you've read Nietzsche.
I'm trying to think of where. I don't know of anything that's derived by Nietzsche from the study. No, I can't say that. But if you think of his concept of Christianity as a religion for slaves, for example, mm-hmm. you might possibly make an induction of that kind. I don't know. I don't think I've done enough homework for this question.
Nietzsche was, as a young man, the most promising classicist of his age. specifically in Greek. Mm-hmm. He always despised the Romans.
When did he live?
He died in 1900, 1901, at the age of 60-something. So he's a Victorian,
essentially. He had a huge quarrel with Wagner. I mean, I don't find him as repulsive as you do. He thought that the Teutonic civilization, the German civilization, should look to the south, to the Mediterranean, to the light, and not to the east, to the traditional idea of Lebensraum and the forest and the Reismiths. And when Wagner composed the operas that celebrated the idea of Siegfried and the forests and the ancient German myths, Nietzsche was appalled and thought there was this terrible betrayal of what could have been a Hellenizing of Germany. So, in which I'm sure he was on the right track, and it's still very remarkable the extent to which classical studies are possessed by German scholarship.
Well Nietzsche was appointed as a very young man, a shockingly young man, to a major philological chair in Switzerland, in Basel, and at a shockingly young age, given how German academics usually work, but he was just perceived to be impossibly brilliant. He had read everything. He'd read the corpus of Greek literature. And he writes his first book, and it's The Birth of Tragedy Out of the Spirit of Music. And it's a book of philosophy, except it's entirely derived from his readings of the ancient Greeks. It's philosophy posing as philology, the study of words, the study of languages. And from there, he never leaves the Greeks. I mean, he keeps doing philosophy, but it's always set in a Greek world. It's always scattered with Greek quotations. And Homer is always the first, the one you can't... sometimes Nietzsche thinks that Homer is the one for whom it started to go wrong. Once, you know, the Greek world, which should have produced, you know, the classic age, went wrong because Homer sent it down a wrong path. Other times he thinks, no, Homer was the right path and Socrates was who made it wrong. But Homer is never out of Nietzsche's mind. So the question is...
And nor is the concept of... I'm getting up to speed now. It's very slow stuff. And nor from Nietzsche's mind is absent the concept of the hero and the Superman. And we use the term Homeric still to describe something, or indeed we use the term epic to describe anything that is apparently superhuman.
What are you going to read?
Or exceptionally noble.
Are we wrapping it up?
No, second to the last.
Oh, second to the last.
You get to choose.
Yeah. This is the climax of the Odyssey, the recognition scene between Odysseus and Penelope. She just can't accept that this man is her husband, so Athena gives him a bath, rubs him down with olive oil. Imagine a craftsman overlaying silver with pure gold. He has learned his art from Pallas Athena and Lord Hephaestus and creates works of breathtaking beauty. So Athena herself made Odysseus' head and shoulders shimmer with grace. He came from the bath like a god and sat down on the chair again opposite his wife and spoke to her and said, "You're a mysterious woman. The gods have given to you more than to any other woman an unyielding heart. No other woman would be able to endure standing off from her husband, come back after 20 hard years to his country and home. Nurse, make up a bed for me so I can lie down alone, since her heart is a cold lump of iron." And Penelope, cautious and wary, "You're a mysterious man. I'm not being proud or scornful, nor am I bewildered, not at all. I know very well what you looked like when you left Ithaca on your long-oared ship. Nurse, bring out the bed from the master bedroom, the bedstead he made himself, and spread it for him with fleeces and blankets and silky coverlets." She was testing her husband. Odysseus could bear no more, and he cried out to his wife, "My God, woman, now you've cut deep. Who moved my bed? It would be hard for anyone, no matter how skilled, to move it. A god could come down and move it easily, but not a man alive, however young and strong, could ever pry it up. There's something telling about how that bed's built, and no one else built it but me. There was an olive tree growing on the site, long-leaved and full, its trunk thick as a post. I built my bedroom around that tree, and when I had finished the masonry walls and done the roofing and set in the jointed, close-fitting doors, I lopped off all of the olive's branches, trimmed the trunk from the root on up, and rounded it and trued it with an adze until I had myself a bedpost. I bored it with an auger, and starting from this, I framed up the whole bed, inlaying it with gold and silver and ivory, and stretching across it oxhide thongs dyed purple.
So there's our secret. But I do not know, woman, whether my bed is still firmly in place or if some other man has cut through the olive's trunk. At this, Penelope finally let go. Odysseus had shown he knew their old secret. In tears, she ran straight to him, threw her arms around him, kissed his face, and said, "Don't be angry with me, Odysseus. You of all men know how the world goes. Now, since you have confirmed the secret of our marriage bed, which no one has ever seen, only you and I and a single servant, actor's daughter, whom my father gave me before I ever came here and who kept the doors of our bridal chamber, you have persuaded even my stubborn heart." This brought tears from deep within him, and as he wept, he clung to his beloved wife. Land is a welcome sight to men swimming for their lives after Poseidon has smashed their ship in heavy seas. Only a few of them can escape and make it to shore. They come out of the gray water crusted with brine, glad to be alive and set foot on dry land. So welcome a sight was her husband to her. She would not loosen her white arms from his neck, and rose-fingered dawn would have risen on their weeping, had not Athena stepped in and held back the long night at the end of its course, and stopped gold-stitched dawn at ocean's shores from yoking the horses that bring light to men, Lampus and Phaethon, the colts of dawn.
Jennifer Werner of Nashville, Tennessee, sent in this email asking what the symbolism is of the olive tree.
That symbolizes the stability and fertility of their marriage, I would say.
Santa Rosa, California, you're next.
This is a great show. I'm much enjoying it. I wanted to raise to your panel the question of 20th century works that are basically retelling story, Odysseus, and the first one is, of course, James Joyce's Ulysses. I'm surprised that I haven't heard about that yet on this show.
Actually, Mr. Hitchens did mention it earlier in the program.
But I hardly got my trousers off. I mean, I should, as Joyce would have said. I mean, I've more to say. I mean, though it all takes place in a single day, Bloomsday, the stops and the tribulations that are faced by Bloom, who is represented as Ulysses, which is the Latin name for Odysseus, and Stephen Daedalus, who is Telemachus, and Molly, who's Penelope, are recognizable from the Odyssean narrative, if you like, from the Odyssey. And Joyce himself thought that the Odyssey was finer than Hamlet, finer than Dante, finer than anything. It was the great test he set himself, just do something that could be mentioned in the same breath. I was going to mention it earlier, when to add not just the number of translations, but the number of adaptations that have been made.
Other 20th century writings?
The most brilliant sequel to the Odyssey is Nikos Kazantzakis, a sequel to the Odyssey, at least that's the title in the English translation, a brilliant translation by Cummin Fryer, which begins as Tennyson's Ulysses begins, when Odysseus is back home. He's bored and restless already. He's only been there a little while. He takes off. He goes down to Sparta to see if Menelaus is ready for action. He's fat and lazy, but Helen wants to do something, and so off they go. And then begins an amazing series of adventures in which Odysseus' quest ultimately becomes a quest for his own transcendent mind. And so doing, he turns Homer's Odyssey inside out. Instead of using naos, mind, to achieve nostos, home, the quest now becomes the quest for mind itself. And after going through a Marxist phase, a Buddhist phase, a Christian phase in the adventures, it's 33,333 lines of demotic Greek, longer than the Iliad and the Odyssey put together. He finally arrives near Antarctica. His last ship, the ship of death, is an iceberg, and his mind finally leaps to the peak of its holy freedom, and he cries out to all of his old comrades, and it's so beautiful. And Helen, who's 90 years old now, lying on the banks of the Eurotas River, dying, attended by her granddaughters, hears the cry of the old world destroyed, and she rises up, says, "Dear God, to feel the wind in my face again at the mast,
If only I could wreck my home once again. Mm-hmm. A beautiful piece, not well known, but again, available in a brilliant translation.
Kasantzakis tells the story of going up into the mountains for a year and a half and taking only two books with him, the New Testament in Greek and Homer, and in fact, if you read Kasantzakis, it's never out of his mind. His autobiography, Report to Greco, is in fact structured on the same, he feels himself to be reliving the Odyssey, and in Kasantzakis' most famous book, Zorba the Greek, Zorba is always pointing out Homeric parallels to his own large living, which of course is finally going to lead to disaster. But
right. The other, when you were doing that very beautiful reading you just completed, I was thinking that rosy-fingered dawn must be one of the many phrases that we owe to Homer. The other of which that everyone knows, or they often don't know where it comes from, is the wine dark sea. And that's the title of one of the novels in Patrick O'Brien's wonderful sequence of naval writings about the Napoleonic Wars. One of them is called The Wine Dark Sea, and it's about the fighting in the Mediterranean, and some of the wanderings of Captain Aubrey and his crew and their vicissitudes are obviously intended to put us in mind
and in fact,
of Homer too. It doesn't count quite as a 20th century adaptation, but as an homage, I suppose you could say.
You might make that even closer, because the Wine Dark Sea is not set in the Mediterranean. The Wine Dark Sea is set in the Pacific and has volcanoes in it. It's one of the ones, isn't it? It's one of the
comes
ones
off
where
the Treason's Harbor. I thought it was in the Mediterranean.
But it seems to be the most Homeric.
I noticed earlier you said only the thickness of a plank away from Calamity, which, if I'm not wrong, shows that you're a Patrick O'Brien fan too.
I am, but there's also, of course, a Nobel Prize-winning poet who's retold.
Derek Walcott
retold it in Caribbean rhythms, in Caribbean verse.
We are quickly running out of time. We'll take this last call from Northfield, Massachusetts.
Well, good afternoon.
Hi.
How are you?
Fine, thanks.
Glad to hear. My name is Christopher Mathey. I'm a student at Northfield Mount Hermon School. And my question for you all is, how would you compare Homer's Hector to Virgil's Aeneas?
They're both dutiful men, devoted to their families and to the gods of their city. Actually, they're quite similar. Although I can't think of his name right now, the hero of Gladiator would make a splendid Hector.
Deborah Dickerson is one who has more recently come to
Russell Crowe.
Russell Crowe.
Thank you. Come
Sorry.
To Homer. Where will you go next? Has this enticed you to go someplace else?
Oh, I thought you meant on the book tour. You meant
No. I actually mean reading some classics.
Oh, and I need to read this again. I mean, 2 weeks was just not enough. There was so much that was in here, so many twists and turns, and I tried to keep notes, you know, a lineage, you know, this guy is the father of this guy, and that guy's mm-hmm. father, and this guy was killed when, and it got really complicated, so I need to read this again, and because this is so accessible and exciting and interesting, I'd like to read this again, and I'd like to read the Iliad. I'm going to get the your translation of the Iliad,
wonderful.
Which I'm sure I'll need to read at least twice, and then I think I might backtrack to the originals. I've heard all these other names of things thrown around that I've never read James Joyce's Ulysses. But I think I need to spend more time with the originals, even the updated originals, because I'm not sure I would get all the references in a more updated reference. So I'm going to spend some more time with these.
Christopher Hitchens, where should we go next? What should we discuss next after Homer?
Much of I traveled in the realms of gold, and many goodly states and kingdoms seen. Round many a western island have I been, which bards in fealty to Apollo hold. Oft of some wide expanse have I been told that deep-browed Homer rules his domain. Yet never did I breathe as pure serene till I heard Chapman speak out loud and bold. Then felt I like some watch of the skies, when a new planet swims into his ken, or like stout Cortes, when with eagle eyes he gazed at the Pacific, and all his men looked at each other with a wild surmise, silent on a peak in Darien. So I think we should do Chapman's Homer, as celebrated by Keats, and invite the professor back to do, and then we should do Lawrence's Homer. We should do
all of it.
This is the most important thing in
Pope's,
the world.
And Pope's Homer.
Yeah. Chapman's Homer and Pope's Homer.
We should do Homer's.
Marvelous works of literature.
We are out of time. Jody Bottom, thank you for joining us today.
Thanks.
Appreciate it. Professor, you want to take us out?
Odysseus' dog. And as they talked, A dog that was lying there lifted his head and pricked up his ears. This was Argus, whom Odysseus himself had patiently bred but never got to enjoy before he left for Ilion. The young man used to set him after wild goats, deer, and hare. Now, his master gone, he lay neglected in the dung of...
Book TV focused on the classics this weekend with a live discussion of Homer's Odyssey. We'd like to know what you think about classics programs on Book TV and any suggestions you may have for future programs. You can write to us at Book TV on C-SPAN 2, 400 North Capitol Street, Northwest, Suite 650, Washington, D.C., 20001. Or email us with your comments or suggestions at booktv@cspan.org. Up next, live coverage of the U.S. Senate. This afternoon, senators will vote on a continuing resolution to keep the government operating through tomorrow night. Meanwhile, party leaders in the White House are trying to work out an agreement on the Labor, Health, and Education Appropriations Bill, along with a $248 billion tax incentives package. Now, live coverage of the U.S. Senate here.